Hi, I'm Bill Patton with 720 Degree Coaching, and it's my distinct pleasure to have Mike Barrell of Evolution Tennis on the show here. Hi, Mike. How are you doing?
Really good, Bill. How are you?
Excellent. Excellent. I'm doing quite well. So tell us a little bit about you and your background. What, you know, for people that might not know you, you know, what, why, is, how have you developed this expertise in this area of tennis for kids?
By expertise, you mean the one-eyed man in the world of the blind, I think. So, it's pretty simple. I started, like most people, I started coaching in a club, and then I started trying to work with higher performance players. And for a while, I was involved with an academy that had, you know, players playing, you know, ITF tournaments and those kind of things, and challenges and those sort of areas. And then I started working with the younger side of things because basically my club wasn't very good at doing it. And so I said I'd take it over as the tennis director, and stumbled my way through that for a few years, and then found that actually it was really, really interesting because I found quite quickly that I was really interested in people more than, not more than tennis, but tennis was my vehicle for understanding, you know, getting to understand people a lot more, what motivated them, understanding what environments to put forward, you know, just what made people tick, really. Then 19 years ago, I became a father, so that helped as well. And that really, you know, you start to try and work out what the hell your kid's up to and how they communicate, and why did they say that, and why did they do that? And I kind of, you know, was a father with a question mark above my head the entire time. You know, what's that about? Why did she react that way? Why is that not what I would think? And that just led me to, you know, what I think coaching is really about, which is understanding what people want, providing for their human needs, and then moving along that line. So worked for federations. I've written, you know, we wrote a lot of the big federation programs in the early days of kids tennis. And now we have a big network of clubs, about 60 clubs around the world that we work with. Through the Evolution program, and mentor them, have great discussion groups. You know, we've had loads of online webinars with everybody in the last few weeks, just trying to, you know, work out where the puck's going to be at the end of this and how we're all going to move forwards.
Yeah, that's great. And, you know, the thing that I pulled out of what you just said is the influence of parenting on coaching is enormous. It cannot be discounted. And I just came sort of to the realization that part of my fascination with athlete-centered coaching is that I have two kids who are wired differently. And so we raised them differently. And when you get that practice, it's like John Wooden said, I coach everyone the same differently.
Yeah, and that's a real interesting one for us all. I think one thing is, as parents, as coaches, we often put our, you know, it's that idea of men's brains and women's brains and how they're wired, and that comedy sketch that you can find on YouTube. We tend to put the things in boxes. So we put our parenting skills over there in a box, our coaching skills over there in a box, and we don't let them cross over and interact, and we see our roles as being really different. And they're not. They're both about growing people. But, you know, talking about you having two kids, you know, well, of course they're different because they were born in different environments. One kid was born with just their parents, and another kid was born with their parents and another kid around. And that's a different environment, and therefore they're getting different influences. And I think people forget how much our environment's shaping us as we grow up.
Well, yeah, but even a little deeper than that too. I mean, yes, so we're getting into nature versus nurture, right? But I'm going to say, even by nature, they're wired differently. They are hardwired to respond differently to different stimuli. So, and we see this, and we began to see this very early on. So it had nothing really to do with environmental stuff yet. But, you know, so, you know, like, for instance, my son, very dutiful and was, you know, and was very much an obeyer of the rules. And then my daughter took after me and was very much the highly intense rebel. And so we had to train them from the place that they came from.
But is your son older and your daughter's younger?
Yes.
That's very typical.
Well, that's,
you know, in other words, first child, much more linear, much more straight line, normally takes most of their personality traits from their opposite gender parent. So your son's probably got more gender characteristics of your wife than you, and your daughter more of you than your wife. And a second child is born into an environment where they have to negotiate or fight or be more interactive in order to get the attention. Whereas the first child, even for their, so we're shaped, I think, very, very early on those things. And, you know, those kind of things are what's really interesting when you're working with kids. You know, is it, what is the family makeup of this kid, and how does he view competition? How does he view, how is it perfectionism? How are they competitive? Like, we know that most of the, approximately 75% of all the world's top 100 men and women are the first child in the family. You know, so they're easier to coach in that way. They're more linear, they're more direct. Whereas second child in the family is the one that wants to talk a bit more normally, and the one that wants to find a slightly different path than the first one. So as a result of that, you don't get quite so many of them, even though, for example, on the boys' side of things, boys generally get more competitive as they move down the order, but they don't get more focused. The first one's always the one that's most focused.
Yeah, and this is an amazing rabbit hole we've already gone down, which I think is awesome. But I want to cap this little section off with, you know, great points, absolutely. And so I think a best practice for coaches, especially coaches who are not parents, is to communicate really closely with parents about who are their kids, what are their traits, where are the buttons to be pushed and not pushed. Those types of things. So absolutely study parenting, study first child, second child, middle child, last child, all of that stuff. You get a lot of wisdom about how to deal with the kids that you get. One thing that's funny for me is the kids come on the court and I get their immediate reaction, and then I interpret their behavior to their parents and ask them if I'm right or wrong. And I'm usually right, but sometimes I'm wrong, and they go, no, no, it's more like this. But it's when you prove that you are very a quick study of the personalities of the kids entering the court, you can win a lot of people that way. So, all right, so let's dive in a little more, or let's get into evolution tennis. So what, can you give us the broad overview of what is it?
For years we developed national programs. You know, we wrote Australia's national program. We've done the Dutch one, the Norwegian one, the early days of the LTA's one in England and UK. So we've got a lot of experience of working with these curriculums that set out, you know, this is what you coach. And you know, the whole red, orange and green thing, it's had an impact, but it hasn't actually, you know, had the impact that people thought it would. It hasn't, you know, spurred tennis into this, you know, amazing number of players that people thought were going to come out. And it boils down to, you know, the old story, which is we focus a lot on what we're teaching, and we don't focus a lot on what environments we're actually building. So we have a three-tier learning model, which is for somebody to learn something, they have to be motivated. And then they have to have the capacity to learn, and they have to have the opportunity to learn. So if you get down to that, it's like, do we understand who the kids are? Do we understand what the environment is? And are we pressing the right motivational button to actually make them learn? And that's what we wanted to do with evolution. So evolution was, if you like, all our best bits. We took them all and we created five pillars that we say, this is what a program is. A program isn't lessons. If you just give lessons, that doesn't mean you're given a program. A program is, first and foremost, have you got competition right? Because competition is a huge tipping point. If you get it right, the kids are super excited about doing more. If you get it wrong, then you can very quickly turn off a whole lot of them. And that means, have you got competition right every stage of their pathway, every stage of their confidence and competence? So that's our first pillar. Our first pillar is actually competition. Okay. Our second pillar is instruction. Our third pillar is social, because we forget how important it is for kids to make friends, and you know how the sports environment is supposed to do that. And the fifth pillar is practice, you know, like a match play, or but because sometimes you want to create an environment like a skateboard park where kids can try things out and test things, but they're not being judged or assessed. And as soon as we put them in a learning environment, they're kind of a bit more focused on, well, I should be achieving this. And then the fifth pillar is just parents. So we create this diagram, which is, you know, like a Venn diagram with all those five pillars, and saying, you know, competition, lessons, social, practice, and parents. And then the secret is how you connect all those five things every time you do something. So if you're running a competition, how did it connect to lessons? How did it connect to what you practiced? Where's the social environment in that competition? And what are you doing with parents? So it's not an instructional program. We have that element like everybody else does. You know, there's loads of instructional programs out there. It's a holistic program that looks at all the things that would meet the fundamental human needs of kids and parents in a sports environment.
Okay, so I want to latch on to one thing, and then we'll go back. We'll go back and kind of go through each of those five things. But when you say skate park and skateboarding has a tradition that is similar to what the tradition of tennis used to be, where let's say a kid's at the skate park and he's struggling with a certain move that's fairly basic because he's very new. A veteran skateboarder will come over and say, hey kid, you want to learn how to do that?
Yeah.
Right. And so here, I'm going to show you this and then you practice it and I'll keep my eye on you. And then they pick up one thing. I mean, I'm thinking back to my interview with Johan Creek, you know, who grew up playing all the old men in his town, right? And he had mentors who told him, hold it like this, you know, and just bit by bit, you know, you got the tennis lexicon of each little bit of the language of how to play tennis installed. So obviously more formalized training and more excellent training comes along later. But yeah, we've kind of lost our way on that piece quite a bit. You know, we've professionalized everything.
Yeah, everything. And I think people forget the origins of sport. You know, even if I say to people, what are the origins of sport? They say, oh, well, it was the Olympics. And they're like, no. Way before that, there were armies battling in the training ground, you know, playing team sports so that when they went to battle, they could collaborate. You know, obviously there are obvious things like throwing a javelin, which made difference, and firing a bow and arrow. But, you know, there were all these competitions that were inherent in training for battle. And actually through that, you know, really developing the certain skills that they wanted. So it was a survival thing, but sport was never intended to be the ultimate goal of the process. You know, the Olympics made sport the ultimate goal. Now you could be the fastest. Now you could be the... Whereas actually before, sport was always a training process for something else. And I think that's the other thing that we have in evolution, which is we're very focused on four behaviors. So we started to get to the point where we said, how do we grow the jungle? How do we get more people playing? How do we get off this, what I call the search for the magic tree? You know, there are so many people that are walking through tennis with the search for the magic tree. Let me find the wonder kid, that you forget all the amazing things you were seeing on the journey. You know, you don't see all those things along the way. You don't look after all those other kids along the way. And I think when we started talking to parents, and I work, you know, a lot of different places and have a lot of different encounters with different parents, and you start to get down to, they're not really informed as to what they're looking for. They're either like, I want my kids to be a professional, or they say, or I just want my kids to play for fun. But really the answer shouldn't be either of those. The answer should be, let's look at sport and what it is and ask ourselves, what are we asking them to develop? And so we have a reward system in the program which overlaps everything, which is focused on four key behaviors. So our four key behaviors are respect, you know, just good behavior, being nice to your opponents, being respectful to your parents, your coach, picking up the balls, looking after your equipment, all those things. The second one is train, which is all about hard work and effort, which is very, you know, mindset, Carol Dweck kind of stuff. The third one is explore. Are you prepared to try something different? Are you prepared to ask questions, answer questions, be inquisitive? And the fourth one is, we call it compete, but for us it's dealing with and enjoying working with adversity. So our reward system throughout the program, for our reward system, the whole program is based on those four things. It's not based on winning, losing. It's based on, does the kid show those behaviors?
No, and those are all incredibly empowering and great life skills moving forward for sure. So now it's time to wave goodbye to the people who are watching on Facebook Live. So wave goodbye. Bye.
Bye, everyone.
If you want the whole interview, then come to my YouTube channel where it will be edited and it's going to look nicer than this anyway. So anyway, so goodbye Instagram, goodbye Facebook Live for now, and check out my YouTube and you'll see the whole interview. Take care. All right, so let's go back to the first pillar again. So what was that again?
Competition.
Competition. All right. Yeah. So let's dig into that a little bit. So what? Let's go in a little more detail, and hopefully we can. What I want to do is like spend a couple of minutes on each one, and then wrap. So we're into competition a little bit. You want to go a little more into?
Yeah. So basically, we have to understand the role competition plays. What's important in competition? So those four behaviors I just discussed. You know, those are the things we're looking for in competition. So it's important that during the practice phase, we train those kids to understand, for example, can they recognize their performance over their result, which is hard for a young kid, you know, because if you ask a kid, would you choose to win six love against a nobody, lose 4-4 against, but play the best tennis of your life, or win 7-6, 7-6 and play the worst tennis of your life? A lot of kids would gravitate towards the first. Most adults will gravitate to number two or number three, but a lot of kids are going to gravitate towards the first. And it's important that we show them the value of those other things, and we can show you the value by those reward systems. You know, it's important that we get the competition right in the club first, so the kids really enjoy it. You know, and again, it comes back to, have we been practicing those skills in lessons? Is there a really good social element in that competition, which you can control in the club environment? You know, have you been doing
that? Yeah.
What are you doing with the parents during that time? You know, how are you doing
Yeah, I mean, there's an important fact that totally affirms what you're saying and the need for intervention, because the USTA did a study and found that the median score, the most common score in a tennis match is 6-love in a set, right? Followed closely by 6-1. And that's not a great competition. So a lot of kids are being turned off by not being engaged in close competition because they're on the losing end of that. So.
Yeah. And we tend to do like competition one size fits all. Like if I presented 50 kids at your club and said, okay, Bill, these are the 50 kids you got to teach, and you could see different sizes and ages, you'd find some way of grouping them straight away. And you go, okay, right, they're going to be one class, they're going to be another class. In fact, that's one of the things we advise. Never do an open sign-up. Always place every kid, because, you know, a kid's worth approximately 150 times a year what they pay for a group lesson. So if they pay $10 for a group lesson or $20 for a group lesson, they're worth $3,000 to your club every year. If that pile of $3,000 was sat on your desk, you'd make sure it went in the right slot, in the right place, you know? But if we do that with lessons, and then we understand competition is such a tipping point for these kids, because if they go and they love it, they'll want to take more lessons and be more involved and get more committed in the club. But if they don't like it, they could be running for the door and running for a different sport. So, you know, too often we present competition as this one size fits all, rather than, you know, here's a competition, enter it, rather than, okay, this should be how these 12 kids play a competition. These 12 over here, the competition should be structured like this.
Right.
You know, if clubs collaborate, hopefully there'll be more collaboration at the end of this process. If clubs have a big enough program, they can do that within their environments. But that's not the job of the USTA. The job of the USTA is to present a structure that once the confident kids are out there, they can go play those events.
Yeah, and that one kid whose parents will plunk down, you know, close to $3,000 are worth much more to you if you take better care of them, because then they will be source of referrals. So I'm a big fan of taking care, really good care of every single person that comes through that gate for that reason, because I know that this is a future of referrals that will come my way.
For sure, yeah, for sure.
Okay, let's go on to number two. So we did competition. What's the next one again?
So instruction, just, you know, a lesson curriculum. We have a set of competencies like everybody does, you know, whether it be the NetGen competencies. Our competencies are very much geared towards six levels of skills so that you can enter at any point. So, you know, when we first started this whole process, we did red and orange and green. When we got deeper into this process, we went, okay, the question that comes up is, well, what if I've got four 10-year-olds that want to join the program that have never played tennis before? So we created a set of competencies that was a progression of skill, and they were adaptable. So, yeah, we all assume the kids on this pathway from red to orange to green, you know, and that every kid, it's almost like we assume every kid joins the program at 6 years old. We know that's not the case at all. So we create a set of competencies that are mission-based, so they're tactical, with rewards and feedback and all the usual things that are in those competency programs. Ours is just a bit more flexible so that you can actually work the kid. And also ours also doesn't assume everyone's going to get to level six. You know, it's like, okay, you might be a green player doing level four skills. Because of the experience we've had in doing these programs before, we kind of realized, yeah, it's good in theory, but once you start putting it out there, not every kid is on the same path. And if you want to create an inclusive environment, you got to really make sure that there's a place for more kids to join the program in different places.
Okay.
But again, that ties back into the competition. So like our competition structures, six events. Right now, we just create a whole at-home competition structure as well that goes between those six events. So we have a world tour where we start off in Melbourne, then we go to Rome, then we go to Paris, then we do London, New York, Beijing, six themed events through the year. Now we have an at-home thing called the Challenge Tour, where every week we create six challenges online in a different city. So this week's Beijing, next week's Munich. We keep going around like that. But the idea of the lessons is they fit between those slots. So if we were on court now, we'd all be getting ready for Paris.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd be like doing the, you know, we'd be getting ready for that event, talking about what we need to do. So like all other sports, we clearly, and like performance tennis, we defined what the end goals are, and the lessons lead to the competitions.
The thing I like about that is it's sort of a sneaky motivational thing where it aligns kids' thinking with what's going on the tour.
Exactly.
So, like one of the incredibly winsome things that Junie Murray does is in her lessons with 6 and 7 year olds, she says, well, this is tour training. Yeah, you can volley like that, but you're not going to beat Rafa that way. And I love that. I mean, it's just matter of fact. It's matter of fact. There's no pressure assigned to it. It's just, you know, if you continue on this path, you might possibly end up on the tour. I mean, I think that's incredible to open kids' minds to those possibilities.
Yeah, I always say, you know, under 10, there's no such thing as a recreational kid and a performance kid, because I've never met a kid who said, when I grow up, I want to be a really bad tennis player. You know, when I grow up, I want to be a 3-0. That's as far as I want to go. You know, it's like they all dream. So you should be, and we're not good at doing that. We're really not good at doing that. There's not a single kid in the world who gets a soccer ball on Christmas morning, runs out in the street and says, let's pretend it's a spaceship. You know, they instantly go out and pretend to be their heroes. And then what do tennis programs do? They say, well, let's play the frogs in the pond game, which is fine if they're 4 and 5, but by the time they're 6 and 7, they already know real people in the real world. So why are we not saying, this is what Roger did when he was 6, or this is what Serena did when she was 7 or whatever. You know, and I'm sure no one's going to sue us for saying those things. It's just like, you know, just get the fire going. And so our challenge tour right now, that's exactly what we've done. We've created, like, we're just following the tour city by city. And you start off with a qualifying quiz. So you're going on Sunday, there's 10 questions. like this week, there's three about actually Hungary and Budapest, and there's a little bit of a Hungarian flavor to it. And then there's a few more like, you know, can you spot the feet of this player, who they are, and about players on the tour. And it's just a question of trying to hook kids into, this is a global sport where you go all around. Well, eventually we'll be back and doing it, going all around the world.
Soon enough. I'm not too worried. But anyway, number three, pillar three.
Well, number three, social. And the thing about social is, you know, we forget how important it is for kids to make friends. And we don't spend enough time actually making sure that they make those connections when we're giving lessons. You know, who are they? You know, one of the things we do with girls, for example, is we never have a group of girls. I never have a mixed group where we have an odd number of girls. We always have a 2, a 4, and a 6. We never have a 3 or a 5. Because if you have a 3 or a 5, now one's always left out. And that's not great when you're working with girls. It doesn't matter so much with the boys. You know, performance tennis is different. One girl with 5 boys works fine, you know, because she doesn't have to deal with any relationship stuff. But as soon as the relationships are a part of the factor, as they are for most girls in sports, you know, girls' team sports don't have a problem, big problem with dropout. And actually, we don't have a huge problem actually attracting girls in the first place. We just have a problem keeping them for long enough. So understanding the needs of people socially, we like who we like. We like going back to places where people like us. We gravitate, you know, and how we can maintain those things. That's a really important pillar, and getting everyone to focus in on that.
Well, and it goes back to what you were saying about respect too, because when you create that atmosphere of respect, then there's a better chance that people are going to be getting along. I mean, I had a situation at my club where I had this one girl who was very intelligent and had some charming traits, except that she would embarrass the other people in the program. And I was embarrassed for myself at the behavior of this one particular girl. So I had to put considerable pressure on her to try to get her to treat everyone else with the commensurate amount of respect. And then after a while, it became too much for her and she left the program. And unfortunately, good riddance. So,
well, you know, yeah, I mean, maybe that's a scenario where it's, you know, I had a scenario with a boy, I mean, with a medical thing, ADHD, and a couple of times he hit other kids with his rackets and that was it, he was gone. And then it's just like, okay, but I'll talk to him privately for 3 months, build my relationship and my rapport with him, and then I could control him better in the group. So,
and that's a wise counter too, is that, yeah, we need to be able to intervene with certain kids and let the parents, the message to the parents should be, look, I'm in it for the long haul. I like your kid and I want to help them, you know, get through this social situation. And I want the other kids to come out of it unscathed. Yeah.
I mean, I was on a court I think I was in Atlanta, and we went on the court and there was two girls walked on the court and with a whole group of boys, and these two girls didn't know each other. And one of them basically looked at the floor for the first 10 minutes. And I said, pulled the coach aside. I said, can we play doubles? And he said, it's not on the lesson curriculum for today. And I said, well, come on, let's play doubles for 10 minutes. So I made the girls play together. And after a few minutes, they hadn't spoken to each other. And then I went across and I said, you know what the boys hate the most? When you win a point against them and then you high five. They hate it when you celebrate. So, you know, they won a point. And then I looked across, they didn't high five. I said, girls, where's the high five? You know? And so they did it. And then I looked, checked in every few minutes. They were doing it more. And then I went across 5 minutes later and I said, girls, you know what the boys hate even more? When you high five, even when you lose, because the boys don't even understand that. So now the girls are high-fiving after every point, laughing, joking, and the coach pulls them back in again. And I said, okay, right. And he starts talking, and he has to tell these two girls, who one of them literally had seen the floor for the first 10 minutes, to stop talking to each other. And he said, how did you do that? And I said, how did you not notice that? How did you not notice that if this girl didn't make a friend today, she probably wasn't coming back next week?
Well, and empathy is such a huge element to good coaching. But anyway, let's keep it moving, though. I think we could go really deep on that. But I think that gives people some good food for thought.
Yeah.
What's number four?
So, well, number four is practice. So if you think about this as being your organized match play or, you know, a club night where all the kids come into the club and, you know, you have all your orange players in one go. The difference between that and lessons is there's no perception. It's about teaching. It's like, okay, one coach and 20 kids or one coach and 30 kids and you're organizing little matches. We use a lot of game situations in that. We'll play games like Black Hole, where part of the court is out today, or, you know, Roll 'Em, where you have to roll the dice before you start the tiebreak and you get 3 points, so the score's never even. And if you roll a 5, I'll roll a 2, the match starts 5-2 to you. We do a lot of those kind of, if you like, competitive skills games in that space, so that the kids are winning and losing all the time, a lot of different matches, but there's no judgment to it. And that's really, really important. You know, you have to understand that kids feel judged a lot more than they ever did before. You know, boys can be very lost in today's world because they don't really understand where they fit. But that's one of the appeals of computer games, you know, e-games and e-sports, because e-sports, you can play your home on your own. You get your score. Nobody comes in and says, I got shot 27 times last night. They come in and say, you know, like, yeah, I got to level 6. So, you know, e-games are really good at rewarding your successes and just allowing you to reset your failures. So we need an environment where kids can play, and it's not a tournament environment where the results count, and it's not necessarily a structured learning environment where you've got to learn this forehand or whatever, but they can get their competitive skills. So we use that for mental training.
Yeah, that's great. And one thing I like about the whole sort of randomized, here's the score you have to start with, is that it's an emotional flexibility test. You know, because there's a lot of different kinds of mental strength. And we generally teach people that they have to push through in all ways and they have to be strong and rigid. But that forces them to become mentally and emotionally flexible, which is a trait we don't often teach. So then, like, let's say that call goes against you and then you don't have the mental flexibility to go, okay, well, I would just cast, you know, these dice that are the score that I don't want. How do I respond? So that kind of trains them to be able to be ready for those moments when they get a surprising result on a call or what have you. They thought for sure they're in, but now it's not. And now it's 30 all instead of 40, 15. So anyway, but let's go on to number 5.
Yeah, but just go back to that one. That's why we have that fourth band, that compete band, is part of our reward system, because we reward you when you accept the adversity. So you can, you know, so we put you in a situation, if you're not put in a situation of adversity, and we also explain to the kids, you know, all these things are going to happen to you in a match. There's going to be a bad line call. You're going to be behind. You're going to be in front. Your string's going to break. And now you're going to be ready for them. And then you know, they accept it really quickly. And they have a lot of fun with it because there's no judgment. If you don't roll a 5 and I roll a 2, I don't expect to win. But if I do win, that's amazing, you know?
Oh, you gave me an idea. I want to have a racket that has broken strings, and all of a sudden you have to play this point with a racket with broken strings.
We have that game. It's called the Monster of the Deep. And the reason we play is, we have a racket that's got broken strings, an aluminum one that's been banged on the ground so many times it's bent over sideways, a little tiny short one, you know, like 21 inches, but you're playing on a 60-foot or 78-foot court, a broken string one, and then we have one called the Monster of the Deep, which has got several grips on it and the old toweling strip over the top, and we leave it in the bath overnight, so it's really sticky and disgustingly wet, and every time you squeeze it, water runs down your arm. We lay all the rackets down, our rackets, your rackets, and basically you roll a dice or pull a card, and that will tell you which racket you're going to use. And, you know, you may get your own racket. You may get, you know, a short one or a broken one or something else. And everything's only for one tiebreak. So it's only 7, you know, it's only, what, 13 points max, and then we're done.
Post-COVID-19, I think the wet racket is going to be retired.
Yeah, but anyway. There's going to be a few things post-COVID-19. I said the other day on a webinar, I think tennis ball manufacturers need to make two colors of tennis balls now, or color the stream or something, because they keep saying no one's going to serve. And I'm like, well, but if you're, all the balls you serve with have got a white seam, but all the balls I serve with have got a black seam, then it's easy for me to find the ball I serve with and you not to touch it. And then we've sorted.
So I don't, I think I don't want to go down the what's going to happen. I don't want to go down that road. But anyway, so
last one's parents.
Parents go.
Well, parents is basically involved in everything, but it's also giving parents practical things to do. Like those four behaviors, we ask parents to look for that and reward that, because those are going to shape your child into a good competitor or a successful human being. We also try and provide things for parents during tournaments. We also have to communicate effectively with parents about every stage of the journey. So the idea of this model is, and everyone goes down the model exactly the way we've done, there are five things, but the strength of the five things is not in each one of the five things. It's in taking one of those five things and sticking it to the other four. So if I took parents, it's like, what do parents need when their kids competing? What do parents need from lessons? What do parents need to understand about practice? How could parents help us with the social environment? So it's taking each one of the pillars, and every time we do something, going back to the other four and going, have we stuck it effectively? So the power's in the glue. Mm-hmm. The power's in how you make all these things cohesive. Because how many programs don't even connect competition and lessons? Let alone all these other things. So that's how we function.
All right. Well, I appreciate your time. And, you know, it's a really detailed description of the program. How can people reach you and or get a hold of your program?
So you can reach us through the website, which is evolutiontennis.net. And if your kids want to get involved in the, or you want your kids to get involved in the challenge tour, which we're actually doing it forever now, but it's available for everybody during this shutdown. Then you can contact us as well through that website or on the Facebook page. It's called EKT Challenge Tour, and the idea is we create 6 at-home activities every week. Kids score their passports, and then they can get on the Wall of Fame every week based on getting their points together. So, it's just trying to look after, you know, provide things that everybody can use and develop a program everyone can get involved in.
All right. Well, I really appreciate your time, Mike, and hopefully I'll see you around sometime soon, somewhere in person, but... Thanks for your time and have a great day.
All right, you too. Thanks very much, Bill.